Well, Dan Joseph, who is sitting in today for Bryan Nehman, the Baltimore Ravens have to find themselves under a lucky star of some kind, because after their terrible loss to the Cincinnati Bengals and they went on the bye week, they ended up, the Bengals did, getting blown out by your Jets, losing to your Jets. And the Ravens came back in good shape. And now, after a loss, really devastating Thursday night loss to Miami, 22-10, the Ravens come into Sunday's game with Chicago in first place because the Steelers tied with Detroit, of all things. Joining us right now to look at all of this is Femi Ayanbadejo, member of the Baltimore Ravens Super Bowl 35 team, as well as partner in the booth with our own voice of the Ravens, Jerry Sandusky, each Sunday WBL contributor. Good morning, Femi.
Good morning, gentlemen. How are we?
Oh, we are fine. I was telling Dan, you can't get into it with Dan. It'd be nice to him. Like, you can't do it with Bryan. You and Bryan go at it. So be nice to Dan, okay, Femi?
Okay, as long as Dan doesn't say anything that sets me off.
All right, I'll do my best. I'll do my best.
Well, let's start with this, though. Okay. We go into Sunday's game against Chicago, I think, in a very good place right now, still in first place in the AFC North. Even though we played a terrible game against Miami, we can really set the boat right with a good performance against Chicago, Femi.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think the Bears are a better defense than Miami. I think Soldier Field's a more hostile environment than Miami. And I think that, you know, losing two of the last three and really understanding that it's about communication and having a plan and being able to execute that plan, I think that the Ravens are poised to, I think, you know, play a good football game this weekend.
Femi, last two seasons, it seemed like there were a lot of Ravens blowouts. It seemed like the Ravens were scoring a lot of points, holding the other teams to very few points. What has changed? Because now the Ravens' wins are very, very close, and the losses are sometimes not even that close. What's the difference maker there?
I mean, you have 20 guys on IR. You know what I mean? You have some of your best players on defense and offense on IR. You know, you don't have the same guys that you anticipated having at starting positions when the season started. That has a big part in it. I think the league changes year to year. You know, guys come and go. You got a team like Tennessee, who's been really good for the last few years under Coach Vrabel. Obviously, Kansas City has been in flux, but they seem to be playing better lately. The Raiders have had internal issues. I just think that every season has its own narrative. I think the Ravens are still a good football team, a well-run football team organizationally. And I just think every year is different. You know, I think that we've been spoiled quite a bit since 2019 with the 14-2 team. And then last year, the team went on a big run. But J.K. Dobbins and Gus Edwards had a lot to do with that. Obviously, Marcus Peters had a lot to do with that. Those guys aren't out there. Mm-hmm. So I think it's a number of different levers that lead to this. That other teams game plan differently and they learn different tendencies. And I think that the offensive line of the three seasons, you know, I think all good teams are built inside out. This offensive line is the least efficient over the last 3 years. And it has a big effect on getting things going, maintaining drives, and also third downs. You know, I think that's been a problem as well.
Femi Ayanbadejo is on board with us. And Femi, mentioning that, we were talking about after the Miami game a little bit about the sacks that Lamar has had to face. I think he's number two right now of quarterbacks being sacked. Can we come up with schemes to get the ball out of his hand quicker, considering that the line is so porous? I'm being nice about that, Femi.
Yeah, yes. I think that running the football and committing more to the run is a good psychological thing to do. But I also think from a strategic standpoint, if you look at what Lamar was able to do in 2018 with that team and to make the run that he made, a lot of it was predicated on running the football. No one can tell me that roster from 2018 is a better roster than this one. I do know that the passing game has improved dramatically. Explosive plays have improved dramatically. Air yards have improved dramatically. But none of that matters if your quarterback doesn't have a clean pocket. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really important to start thinking about different things. And I started saying this after the bye week. Communication, you know, chipping with the running back, really understanding what teams are trying to do. We heard the word zero coverage all week, right? This idea that Miami played man, they walked everybody else up to the line of scrimmage. And if you look, though, they seldom brought seven or eight. They'd bring six, you know, and two guys would drop out and play zone. I think really understanding how to get big on big, most dangerous man, and that comes with full speed work and full speed communication. So I don't think Miami did anything that the Ravens hadn't seen, but coupled with a huge number of plays against Minnesota, a short week. I think it was a perfect kind of recipe for a disaster. And when then when you turn the ball over, you know, Sammy Watkins had probably one of his worst games of his career, gave up on what should have been probably a touchdown, had the first down, and that turns into 7 points for Miami. Those kind of swings, you can't win games on the road in situations like that. And the turnover differential has to be addressed. It is not good. I think the Ravens are minus five.
Yep.
I don't recall them being minus anything in the Lamar era when it comes to the turnover situation.
Femi, the Ravens schedule is backloaded with division games. When you take a look at that schedule for the last, I think it's five of the last eight, right? Is that an advantage for them, or is that something that's going to be difficult for them to overcome?
I think it's both. I think they're in the driver's seat right now. They have the best record in the division going into league play. Those teams haven't really played the Ravens, and the Ravens haven't played them. So the cool thing is that everything is right in front of them. But if we're looking at it as a race, right, and you have to cross a certain threshold of wins, let's say 11, the Ravens are closer to that 11 than everybody else in the division. So is it going to be easy? Absolutely not. Are the Ravens poised and in position to make a run and win the division? Absolutely. And if you think about this, they've already beat the Chargers head-to-head. They've already beat the Chiefs head-to-head. They beat Denver head-to-head. Obviously, I'm looking at playoff seeding at some point in here, obviously. So Tennessee, I think, is the class of the AFC right now. But we know that the minute we put someone to the head of the class somewhere, they have a stumble along the way. So there's a lot that needs to happen between now and January. But I'd say when it comes to the AFC North, the Ravens have the advantage.
WBAO radio contributor there, Femi Ayanbadejo, sits with Voice of the Ravens, Jerry Sandusky, to bring us the games right here at WBAO. Femi, when it comes to Lamar Jackson, let's get to it. He hasn't played the last couple of days. We're told it's non-football stuff, but is this just the load management we always hear? What's going on?
Yeah, I wish I had some insider, you know, info that I could give you. I don't have it. I wish I did. You know, I don't know. You know, Lamar seems to have these little, you know, flu bugs he gets from time to time, whether it's his stomach or something else. I don't know what this situation is. It could be load management, but I kind of thought they would just come out and say that.
Right.
You know, I feel like the Ravens are fairly transparent. So I don't know, but I do know this. This isn't the first time he's had these issues. This is outside of COVID.
Right.
I anticipate come 1 o'clock on Sunday, Lamar is going to be out there in Chicago in Soldier Field getting work done. That's what I anticipate.
What are the keys to the game against the Bears?
Pass protection, absolutely, and no bust on defense. You know, I think the defense played winning football against Miami. It got kind of lost in the horrid play of the offense. And I can just tell you this. I watched all the third downs. The Ravens, I think, were 2-for-14 on third down, 2 or 3-for-14 on third down, which you can't win doing that. They had 14 drives. And these third downs that especially at the first 7 or 8, it was 3rd and 8, it was 3rd and 7, it was 3rd and 9, it was 3rd and 10. There's not a lot of plays for that. So to me, you've got to, I don't care if you're predictable or not, you've got to be able to execute. It doesn't matter if you get cute if you're not getting yards while you're getting cute. And I think that running the football is going to be huge for the offense. And I think, once again, continuing to communicate on defense, Josh Bynes is the number two rated linebacker in the NFL since he started becoming a starter. Number two, that's insane.
That's incredible.
Look at his PFF score. Yeah, he's directing traffic. And I think when he's in there, communication is quicker, better, crisper, especially pre-snap communication. So continuing to do that on defense, finding a way to protect Lamar on offense and run the football, I think they're going to be all right.
Femi Ayanbadejo, final question for you, and then we're going to score before you go, and I know you want to give us one. But anyway, I want to talk about the release of Bell, because what I see in that is Tashaun Williams, who has not been involved. People wonder what's going on. Does that mean now he gets more attention and more carries?
I hope so. You know, I know that there are some football-related things that they want him to do better. And, you know, trust is a difficult thing to get, you know, understanding pass protection, understanding exactly where to run, you know, when there's a 5-yard hole, are you getting 5 yards or more? Or are you getting less? You know what I mean? I think that Tyson needs to figure out where that sweet spot is. But if you just look at the numbers, when he's gotten an opportunity, I feel like he's done well, right? So I think they need to revisit that again. I do anticipate he'll get some more carries. But I think right now, I think all around, I feel like Devontae Freeman is the best all-around back
hard.
In style. Yeah, he does. But also, I'll tell you right now, he did have some mental errors in that Miami game that were a bit costly. But guess what? He wasn't the only one. Mm-hmm. I can point out every single person across the offensive line, as well as the backs and tight ends in regard to whether it was breaking routes off or whether it was recognizing who was actually coming and who was dropping into zone. So it was a team lack of effort, I should say, on Thursday in regard to the offense. But I hope that was just a blip, and I hope that they can find a way to address those issues come Sunday against the Bears.
So give me a score, and we want to get one because we had a rookie quarterback, Justin Fields, going up against, and we do very well against rookies. What do you think, Femi?
I'm going to go 27-20 Ravens.
That's about where I was. 27-21 is what I was going to say.
All right. Well, I'm glad you and I are on the same page.
We usually are. It's like Bryan Nehman guy.
Yeah, we are.
Gets it away. Femi Ayanbadejo. Always great to speak with you, my friend.
Thanks, guys.